Hello, everyone. It's Tony Princiotti, principal guest conductor of the Vermont Symphony Orchestra, with another podcast about great music and great musicians. In this edition, we begin our scene-by-scene exploration of the revolutionary music Igor Stravinsky composed for the ballet, The Rite of Spring, looking at the why and the how of its creation. The full title of this work is The Rite of Spring, Pictures from Pagan Russia in Two Parts. This specific reference to a time and place is important because it determines all the novel musical choices Stravinsky makes in this piece. The story of the ballet is simple. Each spring, a tribe gathers to perform their annual rituals, which include the sacrifice of a virgin, to please the gods and ensure the tribe's continuity. Part one is called The Adoration of the Earth, and it has an introduction that's followed by four short scenes. Part two is titled The Sacrifice. It also has an introduction, and it's followed by five scenes. In this podcast, our focus will be the introduction to part one. One of the things for which The Rite of Spring is most famous is the riot it provoked when it was premiered in Paris on May 29, 1913. It didn't take much to get the audience going. Within 2 minutes of the performance's start, audience members began hissing, booing, and catcalling. To establish what it was that ticked them off, let's take a listen to the first 90 seconds of the piece. So what we have here is music that's lyrical, but it's also dissonant and probably pretty chaotic and random sounding to many ears. And it provides a perfect entry point for me to talk about the very simple, understandable purpose of this music, not only in this introduction, but throughout the ballet. As I mentioned in the introductory podcast for this series, The Rite of Spring has become so famous as a musical work that we tend to forget something fundamental about it, which is that it's a theater piece, so its purpose is to reflect and amplify what's happening on stage. And if we're not aware of that relationship, this music seems much more abstract than it actually is. On the other hand, if our framework for listening to this introduction is defined by images of a distant primordial time, these melodies Stravinsky creates that are popping up left and right like bizarre life forms that gradually combine into a fantastically chaotic ecosystem, well, then we can understand it as a quite conventional curtain raiser that sets the stage for the drama to follow in a very evocative and very sensible way. The formal design of this introduction is just as straightforward. It's a three-part ABA form of the sort that was commonly used for opera overtures back in the 1700s. The A section is made up of a string of responsory melodies that lack a clear tonality, but share the highly ornamented improvisatory character of a type of Lithuanian folk music that dates back 5,000 years and is inspired by the playing of wind instruments called dudki, which were pipes made out of bone or wood. To demonstrate this, I'll play a snippet from an ancient Lithuanian tune called The Patient Maiden, followed immediately by the famous opening bassoon melody of The Rite of Spring and the succession of responses that follow, each one on a different wind instrument.
Oh, Кошкорощей бересе, гейле провергдесе, Ирторада и каречамели, Ирторада и овенемелин, и каречамелин, и гарант, и овенемелин, и шоканс, и каречамелин, и гарант, и овенемелин.
I hope you can hear the similarities. That opening bassoon solo is set in a very high register for the instrument, giving it the strained, plaintive sound of a call to prayer. The responses evoke the gradual gathering and participation of the tribe, and these melodies are accompanied by textural elements that suggest an awakening environment, such as this low, bubbling, gurgling passage for two bass clarinets. And waves of birdsong-like arpeggios played by the flutes and piccolos. The B section brings with it a new character that's marked by intensification and addition. The melodic figures are fanfare-like, with each one seeming to announce spring's annual explosions of growth. Stravinsky then systematically layers back in all the important material from the A section. This sort of additive approach is a basic characteristic of traditional music. And before long, everyone and everything is singing, piping, and buzzing. And then, as you heard, the frenzy is interrupted by the return of the A section and its opening bassoon solo, here a half pitch lower. We've come full circle, and the purpose of this overture has been carried out. All that's left is to make a transition to the first scene of part one, the Dance of the Adolescent Girls, which Stravinsky does by having the first violin section pluck their strings in the characteristic rhythm and harmony of the scene's beginning. And with that arrival, we come to the end of this podcast about the introduction to part one of Igor Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring. If you'd like to hear and watch a performance of this introduction now, just click on the link provided at the end of this video. Next time, we'll explore part one, scene one. Until then, I'm Tony Princiotti, wishing you all happy and exciting spring adventures.